morning, students, and I take immense pleasure to invite all the young minds of the Department of Computer Science and Engineering and another department students and the faculties and as well as the senior faculties of our department to join in this technical festival 14.0, which is a consecutive event to improve the skill development for both faculty and students. We started this in the pandemic situation, and successfully we have been running out this particular program. So this program is coming under the part of Center of Skill Development of Department of Computer Science and Engineering to motivate the faculties and students in what way the technological aspects we can able to enroll as we are in the pandemic situations of COVID-19, in what way we can able to enrich our learning process as well as we can update the technological aspects which is being at present what it is being carrying out actually. So today's session, we just planned it for one step forwarded as like before this particular 14.0, we want to try with different kinds of aspects like where we want to have a contribution in each and every year. So this time we get an opportunity from young minds of our students to contribute for this particular technical test of STEM 14.0. In the name of technological aspects to talk about their views actually. So we get an students from final year, third year and second year, and as well as one faculty is going to be joined with the topic of different aspects like in what way we can able to talk about the known one as well as the unknown one which is known to the both faculty as well as to the students. So the main objective is the learning is the important aspects of each and every kind of method. So that is maybe a faculty or a student. So learning is one of the important aspects that everyone wants to update their knowledge actually. So in that situation where we have different kinds of online courses or different kinds of online platforms are given at present, especially in this pandemic. So in today's session, we have different kinds of topics that we've been arrived with this particular STEM 14.0 actually. So minds to be taken about some basics related to about a website as well as and web applications, and followed by Ms. Aparna from final year CSC will take about blue eye technology. So I appreciate the team of members who have been initiated here and as well as taking this program to be in a forward manner, and followed by Ms. A.G. Lokeshwari from third year CSC will take about the database connectivity related to SQL, and followed by Ms. S. Deepika from second year CSC who is going to take about the sign language using Python. So there are different incidents is going to be added over in this particular STEM 14.0. I'm happy that we get a contribution from which all the year where the students can able to make their updations as well as others to be updated. So learning is a common process that everyone can share their updates to everyone so that they to be updated and others to be upgraded. So at present, let I share my presentation. So first to be taken by minds actually on the topic of what we can able to take about the differences between web site as well as in web publication, what are the different kinds of web application, because most of the people have been having some kind of confusion in what is website and what is in web application, and they have confusing with the mobile application. So they want to have a clear idea. So when you are going to study about the curriculum, especially in third year, like in subjects like internet programming or any other web related subjects, you get a clear idea what is what actually. And so that you can able to clearly know about what kind of applications we are developing and what kind of applications are developing in the social environment. So all this thing you can able to know very clearly. So the framework is very important, because when you especially go for the interview, the framework, they will ask up about the framework section. So this platform, I think, will definitely be useful for you to know about the framework for the web content actually. So let I will share my presentation. So this is the program that we taken about with the name of a technical system 14.0, that the consecutive program that we have been running from the pandemic situation, that we given a name known as a smart learning for this program. So why I'm giving again an introduction, because second year students have been newly joined over in this particular session, So they want to know about in what way the activities are been happening in the department, in what way they can able to enroll them to enrich their platform, as well as they can have an opportunity both in communication as well as in the technological aspects to do their knowledge actually. So in today's session, we are going to see about the difference between a web application as well as a website actually. So that will be taken by mine. So let I introduce myself because second year students are new to this particular platform. So I'm Dr. M. Jyotish Kumar, an assistant professor as well as a head of Department of Computer Science Engineering. So before going to see about a website as well as in this application, we want to know some of the basics related to why we specifically going for this particular topic. So we done some of the background works related to this particular topic, and we get some kind of statistic information related to the present year, the 2021, how the websites are being available, in what way the domains, which what we count as an area, in what way these domains are being segregated. So you can see that in this particular background work, like around in 2021, there are about 1.86 billion of websites available in 2021. That is being ever day by day, that has been increasing actually. So where you can able to see about when this much of billions of websites have been available, in what way the networking capability as well as the domains available, you can see at the left side what are the different levels of top level domains which has been having this 1.86 billion of websites in 2021. How this has been segregated, you can see at the left hand side that it has been segregated with .com about 151.8 billion of domain names available, and .cn or .org is about taking 10.3 million of domain names actually. So these are all the different way where your websites are being segregated, and why this development is been happening, especially in the last of this pandemic situation. There are the growing of the websites has been exponentially increased actually, that you can see at the last actually. The graph shows at the last actually that how the exponential growth actually. So there we have a linear growth where you have a step-by-step growth, where you have an exponential growth. So exponential growth especially happened starting from 2019, the pandemic situation which occurs. So from that particular moment of time to till now, there are multiple websites by providing the different kinds of online courses and different kinds of business aspects and different kinds of product development. So all these things to be available, especially in the last of this 2 years actually. So that is why, that is another one aspect why we are getting this much of websites to be growing exponentially. And most of the present websites are now integrated with your artificial intelligence, as well as machine learning, with the name of a chatbots or with any other additional inputs to be taken to learn about what is the user experience or user interfaces. So all these kind of aspects are taken in the last years actually. So this is a general information that I want to have a background to know about why we specifically going for this particular topic. And these are all the different aspects that what we can able to do that most of the websites, especially in the last year of 2020 to 2021. So these are all the different websites that mostly viewed by the users actually. So that you can see that google.com is been at the star, is at the top by taking about 17.35 billion visits per month of this particular website itself. And that will be calculated in the name of bounce rate. So when you are free, you can go and see about what is the definition for bounce rate actually. So the bounce rate has been higher for google.com actually, followed by YouTube and some social media like Facebook, and followed by some web store applications and an online product application like Amazon and Wikipedia. And so most of the people will see about this particular thing as an website. But why I just specifically taking this particular website and all, especially when I talk about wikipedia.org. So Wikipedia is one of the globally available information that has been shared to all the people. So in that particular situation, we want to know about whether this particular Wikipedia is going to be available in location-based information. For example, I've been from India, and some people from US, some people from Germany, some people from UK. So that particular moment of time, I want to have the platform availability based on the location where the users are available. Based on that, I want to change my content to be displayed to the information. So If this is going to be happen, then I will tell you that is a, not a website, that is a web application. So make it the statement to be clear that most of the people will take it, this is as a website. I agree with that particular statement. But one thing you can able to clarify with the statement that when there is an, every moment of time, there is a location-based changes are available, which means that there is a dynamic things is available in this particular website that depends upon the location. You can able to change the input whether you are going to carry out with the name of your local languages or whether you are going to change it with some other languages. So this kind of adaptability is needed. So what is needed in the sense, when you are giving that kind of information, you are giving a request to the outside of your system, that what we call as an services with the name of where these services are available. These services are available in the name of a web server. So all these things to be, we will work it on this particular applications, especially in the background of before going to the topic actually. So when I talk about the website, so let us understand what is actually the websites and what is actually the web application to be made. So here they given very clearly about from two sources I taken about the information, what are the website actually. So one is I taken from Wikipedia. That website is a collection of web pages and related content that is identified by a common domain name and published on at least one web server. Okay. So when I take about a website, we want to be have different kinds of understandability to be needed. For example, there is a primarily to know about what is a website and what is web application. So to clear the confusion between the web application and the website, remember that the website is information, but static actually. But while the web application is information, but interaction of the user or interaction from the user or interaction to the user. So the key difference is then interactive. Okay. So that is a one step I've been forwarded to the presentation as well as to the topic. Know about in what way the website as well as the web application is being deployed in the sense. The key difference is interaction. So when you make some kind of interaction, so what is the meaning of interaction that the user experience or the user is retrieving some data, the user is been changing some information based on their mood and based on their connectivity. So all these things to be coming under the name of the name known as an interactivity. Okay. So another one kind of a definition I get it from Wikipedia that website is a collection of publicly accessible, that is an interlinked website that share a single domain name that as you were in the T in the Wikipedia. The website can be created and maintained by individual or a group or a business or an organization to serve as a variety for purpose actually. So let us be understand with the example, let me go for an online presence of the clothing stores. Be sure that just being a present on online does not mean that it is an online shop. Okay. So let imagine about the two scenarios that I want to give it for you. So one scenario is the website containing information, menus, like location guides and operational hours. So all these informations are available, but it is static. So if it is static, then we will call it as a website that can be developed with different programming languages. An online web services of clothing stores where you can learn about various informations, menus, location guides, operational hours, and as well as place the order along with the customization of option for the size, color, and other features. So the user has control and is having interacting on the web. This is what we call as a web app. Or we call it as a web application. So web application will be rely on the dynamic user input. For instance, for example, you are ordering a small size of shirt in black color. So that particular moment of time, the application communicate with the database to retrieve other orderings information. So the obtained information is then displayed on the screen. So there are some of the key differences that what the website as well as the web applications can able to take. So let me go for the basic thing about in what way the web application as well as the website will be deployed. So when you take about the website will display the information to the visitor, where web application both display the information and allow the user to interact with the users and some other users and respond to their request. So where website does not require any login or password to perform any specific actions, and most of the web apps require a user to sign up to perform a specific task. So for example, I will give you one example. So recently we developed a set of projects for the Department of Police with the name of an online parking system, which contain every user want to register their username as well as the login. So think it that that is not a website, that is a web application. Okay. So because the user is having some kind of interaction, the user is giving some kind of legitimate information to the system, that system can able to evaluate, or system will be able to analyze the given information, whether it is right or wrong, and it is being go to the web server and check it, whether the person is being a right person to enter over or not. Then the application is, or the content, whatever you develop, is being available to enter into the particular content. So that will be called as a web application. So that is another one thing. But one thing to be to clear out in the sense at present, because secondary students are also available. So what I can able to make it out that particular kind of applications, you can call it as a dynamic pages. So that is a very simple thing that you can able to understand about. Okay. For example, when you are going for a compilation process where website does not require any kind of a pre-compilation is needed, but definitely when you go for web applications, it needed to run the web server before the client, or before the index page is going to be open for the user. There should be some kind of background servers are needed that should be ready out with that different kinds of input. So web app requires a pre-compilant before the deployment actually can go for it. So let me go for the next slide to see about some more information about what is website which containing about, because most of the people want to know this particular formula, especially the third year students, those who are studying about the subjects with the name known as an internet programming, or the IT department is having the technology. So all the students want to know this particular formula. If you know this particular formula, then the development of application will be easy for you. So there are two kinds of websites development is being available. One is your static page as well as the dynamic page. So when you are developing the static pages, actually you need these three kinds of people to be available with you. That is an HTML, CSS, as well as a JavaScript. So all these people will take some kind of responsibility. For example, when you take an HTML, HTML is one of the markup language which mainly concentrate about in what way the content should be formatted, in what way the user will go for an interface. And when you go for CSS, which what we call as in cascading style sheets, presently we have CSS3 and SCSS. So all these things will represent about some kind of styling is needed when you are representing some kind of content. Additional with this, some basic level of interactivity like designing the buttons or designing or applying any kind of an animations on the given images. So all this kind of things to be needed with the name of the JavaScript section. So even JavaScript can also have the basic level of integrity, like it is not needed to go to, for example, let me take this example. For example, I want to check it about the username and password which is given by you. Let me consider I given the username and password to you. For example, your username is admin and password is 12345. So for this particular, most of the people will think that I want to specifically need a web server or specifically need a database where I want to go and check over whether the admin is the username and password is 12345. So all these things I want to check it out whether this information should be needed or not. But when you go for JavaScript, it is not needed about even without the background connectivity of the database, the web server. You can have the small level of an changes, or you can have a small level of an interaction with the JavaScript itself, where you can able to write a script level of codings by checking about your username as well as the password. So even if you want to check it out, you can go to our website like arunai.org/attendance. We just applied not any databases. We applied with the JavaScript, and we just go for it to simply take it out about the username as well as the password. The user can able to enter into the website actually. So the static web pages will need this kind of basic, these four ingredients, the three ingredients. So when you go for dynamic pages where we want to have an interaction with the web server, we want to have a connectivity to the cloud. So all these kind of aspects are coming under the background of dynamic pages actually. So that particular moment of time, for example, very application that you are using now and you are used before, like your online payment that what you are doing in our college website like arunai.org/admissions. So when you specifically go to that particular URL link, that application is being available with the dynamic pages section. Because when I've been connecting with it, so dynamic pages is not meaning that the contents are dynamically changing. When you are interacting with the web servers, when you are interacting with the databases actually, that particular moment also there is a dynamic web page available. So what is the specific need of a dynamic page? For example, let you check it about your online university website. when you are giving your username, when you are giving your registration number, there is the information has been specifically given for you. So another person is also entering his particular register number, and that, so both the people are giving different kinds of input and getting different kinds of output. So this different kinds of input will be taken to the web server and followed to the database to check about the given register number, and as well as the respective information will be given to the front end. So all these things will be also coming under the part of a dynamic page. So the AnonSP website, which where you are reading about the your results, that has been coming under the dynamic pages. So when you want to have the dynamic pages, definitely we want to have some kind of servers who needed to run the services actually. So when you take that particular one, for example, you can say JSP Java server page. So that particular moment of time, if you want to have a dynamic page, then you want to learn about these three people, then you can able to develop a dynamic page. Like you want to know about Java and the basic HTML with JavaScript, then you can work it with JSP. And when you want to have a server with the name of an ASP.NET, that particular moment of time you want to have VB.NET as well as HTML, CSS and JavaScript. And as well as most of the people or most of the present development of dynamic pages, like even if you go for Yahoo or even if you go for a Facebook, everywhere that the PHP at the background to be loaded, because that is one of the popular framework and as well as the popular web server which has been supporting most of the applications, especially in both website as well as in the Android based applications. So when you take about PHP, that the PHP will be available with different libraries like Laravel. So when you have to go and check it with Laravel, L-A-R-A-V-E-L, Laravel. So Laravel is one of the beautiful framework in the front end that has been available with PHP, what way we can able to effectively make it. For example, even our college website, which is what you are having with your payment gateway that you are running with the website like arunai.org/admissions, that page is being specifically designed with the Laravel, with the framework, with the supporting of the PHP actually. So that is one example I can give it for you. So now most of the frameworks that we are making some kind of interactive admins or something like admin dashboards, everything is been coming under the PHP with HTML and CSS. So these are all the what are the different kinds of top websites that every one should know, especially in this pandemic situation of this 2021. So when you take about this particular one, for example, the top 10 websites tends to be expert in 2021. So when you talk about the website, so that particular moment of time, what kind of the content you should design when you want to have an top one of the website which is been available? One is a full page header. So what is the meaning of full page header? In the sense, it is being gained popularity in recent years, especially where, for example, when you are going for business and you have been struggling for to make the website the home page to be very catchy and appealing. So what we want to do it in the sense, generally one thing you should know that as a human, the attention of a human for any kind of a content will be available only for 8 seconds. So if you want, again, I will repeat the content what I've been making out. As a human, we have an attention on any particular concepts on seeing, especially the websites, their mind setup as well as everything should be taken, concentrated only for 8 seconds. So after 8 seconds, it has been deviated. So you want to catch up the human mind within the 8 seconds with your website. So if a visitor is coming to your website, you have less than 8 seconds to catch up your attention. So when you want to have this within 8 seconds, you want to catch up the user attention. So make it out in what way your design should be made actually. Okay. So this is not possible if you are having an unclear home page. So some home pages are being unclear where they are not come to say over what actually the website is being designed for it actually. So the full page header is resolve this hurdle where you can put up a catchy or well-designed headers with your brand names and explain what you are in the couple of lines you are going to do. So give it your logo, give it your slogans and make it some kind of prototype design for you. So even, for example, you can book an appointment or discuss with your project or so all these things to be made. So you can also hire some web developers to include some videos or the sliders in your header to prove the more information to the visitor section. And the second one is we called as on white spaces. So white spaces is very important whenever you are redoubting the content section. So as we move forward, the modern web designs is turning back to minimization. So which means that where they are applying some kind of most of the contents are available, that will be go for the trending action. So the white space on your sites make scanning easy, so that your visitors can able to grasp more kind of information in less time. Secondly, it's allow you to have some user to have a brief action. So if the more content is going to be displayed at the moment, the user cannot able to view all the content section. If you bombard the visitors with the large chunks of text, then it will be overwhelmed on end on the existing your website. So thereby you cannot able to develop the best web development companies or the white space, especially the white space is being needed, especially when you are taking some kind of headers and followed by subheaders and as well as the content. And next one is the scrolling transformations. So every user site is not just navigating the page, they are interacting with your website. So website development experts are adding responses to acknowledgement. These interactions or one of the scrolling transformations or animation to the website is mostly needed actually. And the next one is known as a digital interpreting of physical products actually. So digital interpreting of physical products is very important. See, for example, this is very important while you are developing any kind of a product-based information. So you want to clearly mention what actually your product, and at the same time, the user will want to have some kind of experience that, like whatever the product you display, which is to be catchy over there, that should be the one where the user can able to take it very clearly. So the companies often struggle with selecting the right media elements for the sites actually. So choosing the right images and graphical elements that send a clear messages to the users can be a challenging. But if you sell a product, you don't need to do this kind of brainstorming, okay? But that is the one thing that you want to carry out. And as well as for the user experience and user interfaces. That is the present trending that every websites are applying with user interface, like graphic designs or the what kind of fonts we can have. Most of the, when you go for, especially in the website, you can able to represent that sans serif is one of the beautiful text font which is being taken in the websites. So I have an investigation why that sans serif is one of the text font which is being available in most of the website. In the sense, there is one kind of an artificial intelligence analysis which is being made it that the sans serif will be taken about cool for the high, and which is make the intention for the users to visit in the front of a website, especially seeing the content that will be very easy for the users to view the content. So that is why that particular font is being chosen in compared to other fonts actually. Okay, so when you go for user experience and user interface, then make the elements to be appear very clearly defined, and especially the changing color things, that is very, very important actually. Suppose, for example, let me consider that you are a yoga trainer actually, and you provide all the online yoga sessions and all the things in the website. So yoga is actually the health and wellness practice. So your website should have a color of some kind of peace and some kind of spirituality. So the blue is the color which is being used for the spirituality or the color of choices that you can able to apply. So in that particular situation, if you are designing your yoga website with a black color, or on the other hand, it will be look like, and because black color is a representation of evil, or it will go for some other unwanted thing. So it is on the yoga website with the contradiction your message and confuse the user actually. So the color tendency, that the color psychology charts below, which what you can able to take a note. I will give you a separate session for you in what way the color that you want to give it for websites if the time permits actually. So these are all the different aspects that you can work it out for the designing of websites. In present situation, these are the different aspects is being taken to make your websites to be a popular one. So let me go for the web applications. So when you go for the web applications, what are the different kinds of web applications that you can able to develop, or in what way the web applications will be needed? So web application is one of the set of interactive web pages. It's known to be a web application as where a web application allow the users to give an inputs, retrieve it and get results in different ways, where the web application is similar to the mobile application, but not the same. But the difference is that mobile application, web application is that available on the internet and can be accessible on the web server. So very simply, I will tell you what is web application. For example, you are working with your MS Word as a document or in any PowerPoint or Excel in your system. So what you are having over there, for example, what are the different kinds of activity you are running in that particular document when you are designing any kind of a content? You are opening the page, you are checking the spell checking, you are designing some kind of fonts, you are applying the font styles. So all these things to be available only in your system. But let me consider about the Google Docs. So Google Docs, where are you opening the Google Docs? The Google Docs is opening the web server, But whatever the content that you have been opening and whatever the edition is been making, whether it has been available in your system, definitely not. So these are all different kinds of functionalities. For example, opening is one functionality, saving is one functionality, checking up about the file is one functionality, and chatting is one functionality. So when you open the document in your system, that is being available in your particular system, that will be called as an application. But the same application, when you are opening through the web, and all the interfaces and all the functions which is needed for the Google Doc, it is being available in the web server. That is what will be called as a web application. So now we can able to get a clear idea of what is web application. For example, you are opening a Gmail. Gmail is also a web application. Even if you go for WhatsApp web, I think everyone having a WhatsApp web to be connected to your system, to have an interaction or to know about in the system itself, you can able to have that particular WhatsApp availability. So even WhatsApp web is also one of the web application, even some social medias, whatever you are using. So every kinds of aspect we are working with the web application, like Google Docs, or it may be a Google Excel sheets, or it may be a Google Slides. For example, we go for the Gmail. So what are the different activities that you are going in the Gmail? You are at the moment you are working with the Compose Mail, you are chatting, you are having a calendar, you are having multiple kinds of add-ons. So whether you are all the add-ons or all the applications or all the calendars, everything you are open in the web browser. So web browser is one of the platforms that the web application can able to view. I'm agree with the point. But at the background, what are all the applications that you are opening and what are all the interaction that you are making? Everything is not available in that particular browser. It is mean interaction with the web server and interaction with the databases actually. So this is the one of the web applications that everything want to know. So for example, when web applications run on the web browser, it's not required to be installed. So that is one of the advantage. So web applications are supported by most of the modern browsers like a Google or it may be like a Firefox. So web applications can be updated without sending an updated notification to the user. They are easy to maintain actually. And web apps have no compatibility issues, especially that is very important while you are working out. And web app is very secure and easy to back up, especially when you go for Google Docs products. Okay, and web application development is more affordable than the mobile application development actually. So in simple term, when I want to tell about the web application operates on the web server and can be easily accessed through the web server via the internet. Okay, so this is the one thing that you want to take it about the information that you needed. So, sir, I want to develop a web application. So I just know about some kind of information. I know about some kind of basic things. So I want to develop a web application. So when I want to develop a web application, what are the required skills I need to know? See, when you want to know about to develop a web application, definitely you want to know about how the server side scripting you want to do it. So the first thing you want to know, what is the server side, that in what way the you can handle, like what are the server sides I give in the previous slides I given, like JSP or ASP.NET, or it may be a PHP. So all these things to be concentrate on server side, and you also want to know about client side scripting language, where the user is going to have an interaction like a JavaScript, HTML, and CSS. And for the designing purpose, you want to know some kind of content like the designing process like Photoshop and CMS, the content management system that you want to work it with, predefined content management system like WordPress or Joomla. So all the things should be available at the background if you are working with the web application. So mail.google.com. So that is a good example I want to give it for the Gmail web application, where it is responsive for any devices that are built connected to native application, that may be an Android or an IoT device. So it is a powerful and it is a simple application with the functionality like emails, calendars, Google Drive, live chats, and more and more. So when you talk about twitter.com, so that is one of the social media platform which been invented with 128 characters, which what called as a tweet. So which is a simplified layouts and moderated content and powerful service. It is easy to see how the 13 years in the making of it is about one of the most widely used social media platform on the in the given environment actually. So Wikipedia, that everyone know about Wikipedia, that presently I just told. So when you take about the Wikipedia, it is an actually a powerful multilingual web app. So most of the people will be see like a website, but we will not see like a website as a technical aspects. We will see like a web app actually. Why? In the sense, because Wiki having a knowledge base enable the users to view based on collaboratively modify the content and structure based on the user availability, like what I just told about the where the users are available, based on that the location we can able to change the connectivities actually. And these are the different platforms especially that you should know about when you are developing a web application like an Angular, and ASP.NET, Node.js and PHP. So if you want to start up, very basically you can start up with the last one, PHP. So that will be giving some kind of comfortable for you, because you already having some basic knowledge in HTML. So that in the PHP, you don't want to go for pure PHP, but there will be some supporting PHP will be there while you go for connectivity with your database as well as with the web servers. You want to have installed some basic level of software like WAMP server or XAMPP server. But if any sessions available, I will have a session on that particular area. So these are all the different frameworks that is being needed to develop. And by last, I want to tell about what are the web applications. When you are developing a web application, what are the 7 steps that you should follow it? One is define your problem. That defining a problem is very important. And plan the workflow in what way your algorithm or the flowchart that you are going to design for the given application. For example, recently we also developed some applications. So first we define your problem. The problem, once you define, then we can able to convert it to the flow in what way it is being expressed. And followed by, you can develop a simple level of an exercise like a prototype model that you can present it to the customers so that they can able to know what are the different kinds of input that you can give, or you can able to enrich the given information. So all these things you can learn it in the third step, and you can validate your prototype by the valid customers. And finally, you build your web application. And once you build your application, then go for testing your application, because testing will application is needed there, because when 1,000 people are opening your application, whether there is any kind of an issues available or any server is being dumping over there. So all this kind of testing you can able to meet it. Or whether the user giving an input is the legitimate information. So when that particular thing available, you want to give a constraint over there by applying some kind of patterns actually. So all these things should be dumbed in the level of 6 actually. And finally, you can host your web app. So this is what I concluded to know about what is the difference between website and web app. I think you get some kind of knowledge, especially in this website as well as the web app. And in future, we can get some kind of different aspects that we can talk about, especially in the name of technology. So thank you to be in the part of this STEM program. For more details, you can visit our college website with the name of arunai.org/STEM action. I welcome Ms. Aparna to take over the session. Aparna is on the line.
Yeah, yes, sir. Am I audible? With pleasure, sir. Thank you, sir. Good morning, everyone. It's my immense pleasure to welcome you all to the STEM 14.0. First, let me introduce myself. I'm Abarna from final year CSE department. Let's start the session. Have you guys just imagined a world where computer can interact with us as we interact with each other? Okay, let's imagine a situation. In a fine morning, you walk onto your computer room and switch on your computer. It tells you good morning, and it understands that you are in a bad mood today. And then it opens your mailbox, shows you some of your mails, and tries to cheer you. It seems to be a fiction for every one of us, but it will be a life led by Blue Eyes technology, which is our topic today. The objectives of Blue Eyes technology is that, what is Blue Eyes technology? Why is Blue Eyes technology? Technology behind this technology? How does it work? Applied sciences in technology. The main idea here is to give the computer the human power. It's an eye for technology. It's interesting in case when hands-on work, a new technology tracks eye movements for computer operation. Normally, emotion and facial expression plays a major role in interaction with human beings. This technology aims to create a computational mechanism that have perceptual and sensory abilities like human, which enables a computer to gather facts about human and interact with them. Let's see what Blue Eyes technology. Blue stands for Bluetooth, and it's interconnectivity for the technology. Eye signifies the information perceived through eye movements. This technology can sense and control the emotions of human. It observes the facial expression of human beings and respond to them accordingly. It actually uses a camera and a microphone to identify user's action and emotions. The machine can understand what a user wants, where he or she is looking at, and even realizes her physical or emotional states. Why is Blue Eyes technology? To avoid the human limitation, we are using a tiredness and oversight mental illness. To reduce these limitations, we can use the computer by using Blue Eyes. So monitoring a conscious brain involvement, the Blue Eyes technology can be used to lessen the mental illness of human being. to build a machine that can understand everyone's emotions. Some of the technologies of this are, normally, Blue Eyes technology is a combination of both hardware and software components. DAU, CSU. DAU stands for Data Acquisition Unit. CSU stands for Central System Unit. These two devices are interconnected by Bluetooth. Actually, the purpose of DAU is to collect the information from the sensor and forward it to the CSU for processing and verification purpose. The SUTA stands for a simple user interest tracker, and artificial intelligence as well as emotion mouse are equipped with this technology and understands the speech and the identity of everyone at an instant of time. This manual and gaze input, it's also called as magic. It has two magical points, that is the conservative and the liberal. Needs for Blue Eyes technology. Normally, human error is a major cause for most natural calamities. It's amazing to build a machine that can understand everyone's emotion. A personal computer can listen, talk, or scream. It verifies your identity, feels your presence, and interact with you. Make computers and humans work together as partners. The main task of DA is to fetch the information from the data, from sensors, and send it to the CSU to be processed. Personal ID cards and PIN codes provides operator's authorization. Communication with the operator is carried on using a 5-key keyboard, a small LCD display for sound. This ATMEL89C52 microcontroller is a system core. A JAS multi-sensor interface is used. Beeper, LCD display, LED indicators have a voltage level monitor. The features of DAU are, it's lightweight, it runs on battery so that it consumes low power consumptions. It's also easy to use. It works on a sensing mechanism that uses the microphones and video cameras to understand human action. The parameters like heartbeat rate, eye movement, etc. are notified by supervising system. It also uses a high-end eye movement sensor integrated with a CMOS camera to track the point of gaze. And it identifies that where the operator is looking at. We'll see applied sciences. There are many emotional sensors used here. For hand, we use emotional mouse. For eyes, we use expression glasses. For voice, we use voice recognition. For face, we use facial recognition glasses. Some of the behaviors of emotional mouses are, the mouse movements are presented, button click frequency, finger pressure when he or she presses his or her button. Physiological information is, the heartbeat rate can be monitored by ECG or electrocardiogram, skin temperature, skin electricity. User interest tracker, it is also called a SUTA. It has the ability to maintain a bond between human and computers. It analyzes the user's reaction that his eyes focuses on PC screen. It has the power to decide what's the topic of the user. Speech recognition. Input words are scanned and matched against internally stored words. Users can use microphones to speak to computers. For example, it's considered a pilot uses a commands to computers by speaking into microphones. It's also known as magic point, which helps in the reducing the cursor movement required for target selection. There are two main approaches used here, liberal and conservative. Liberal in the sense where the user is warped to every new object user is looking. Conservative means the warping of the user is activated when manual input is given. Eye movement sensor. A wearable device which allows any viewer to visualize the confusion and interest level of viewer. For example, by remembering the type of websites that the user links accordingly to the mood and time of the day, the computer could reach on a related size and suggest the result of the user. Benefits. It supports eye monitoring by interpreting and recording human movement. It's widely used in new generation video games to make them more reactive and exciting. It proves to be helpful technique in flight control centers, power plant control rooms, and captain bridges. Some of the advantages are, it reduces manual work, physiological condition monitoring, visual attention monitoring. It is used in video games to make them more interactive and exciting. Applications are, it's mainly used in militaries, ovens, and refrigerators, video games, etc. This technology can be mainly implemented in schools and colleges also, so in the field of education, so that the staffs can observe the students' physical state and physiological states. Conclusion. This technology ensures a convenient way of simplifying the life by providing more delicate and user-friendly facilities in computing devices. Final words I'd like to conclude is that the gap between the electronic and physical work is reduced. Surely in few years, it may reach our handheld mobile phones. The computers can run using explicit commands instead of implicit commands. Even the machines can see and feel too. Let's see a small clip about this. Gain some knowledge about this Blue Eyes technology. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Aparna, for a wonderful session related to the Blue Eye technology. I think your presentation will give the knowledge related to learn about in what way the artificial intelligence and the machine learning is mainly needed over, especially in the development of present aspects, actually. So I thank you for getting some kind of inputs related to the Blue Eye technology. So now I welcome the next speaker, Ms. Lokeshwari, to take over the session on SQL.
Respected teachers and my dear friends, my name is A.J. Lokeshwari, third year CSE department. So today I'm going to explain the topic SQL Structured Query Language. Objectives of this topic is introduction to SQL, what is SQL, how is SQL in SQL Server, what SQL can do, or RDBMS. Introduction to SQL. Its developer is ISO and IEC. It was designed by Donald D. Chamberlain and Raymond F. Bioser. It was first published in 1974. SQL is a domain-specific language used in programming and designing for managing data, helping a relational database management system. The statements are used to perform many operations on a database, such as retrieval of data, updating data, removing and renaming data, and deleting data. Oracle Sybase Microsoft SQL Server is some of the database that use SQL language. We cannot call SQL a programming language, but it has some standard to create producer extension of so that the factorials can be extended to form a programming language. SQL is a standard language for assisting and manipulating database. IBM implemented the language originally called SQL, has thought of the system or object in the early 1970s. The first commercial database was released by Relational Software, later become Oracle. What is SQL? SQL stands for Structured Query Language. It is basically a language used by database. It allows to handle the information using the table and show a language to query this table. Other objects related like view function and producer, etc. SQL can be used only for relational type database, not for others. SQL is a query of a relational database, which is used to assisting and managing their database. SQL is similar to other programming languages. SQL in SQL Server. SQL Server can be divided into four: DDL, DML, DCL, and TCL. DDL, Data Defined Language. It can be used to create allot, drop, and truncate. DML, Data Manipulation Language. It can be used to select, insert, update, and delete. DCL, Data Control Language. It can be used to grant and revoke. TCL, Transaction Control Language. It can be used to begin, commit, and roll back and save. data defined language, DDL. It can also known as data description language. It provide command form definitional commands to insert tuples into and delete tuples from and modify tuples in the database. The structure used for managing data within schema object. Some example: select, insert, update, delete, and call. Select, retrieve data from a database. Insert data into a table. Update, updating existing data within a table. Delete all records from a table. The space for the record remain. Call a SPL and SQL or Java subprogramming. Data control language, DCL. A data control language is a syntax similarly to a computer programming language used to control access to data storing in a database. In particular, it is a component of structured query language. Some example: grant and revoke. All specifying using to perform specifying task. Revoke, cancel previous grant or denied permissions. Transaction control language, TCL. Transaction control language commands are used to manage transaction in database. Changes made by DML statement. It also the statement to be grouped together into a logical transaction. Some example: command, rollback, and save point. Command. The command is used to permanently save any transaction into the database. Rollback. The command restore the database to last comment state. Save point. The save point command is used to temporarily save a transaction so that you can roll back to the point whenever necessary. Embedded SQL and dynamic SQL. Define how SQL statement can be embedded with generally purpose programming language such as C, C++, Java, COBOL, and etc. Integrity. The SQL DDL integrity components or specifying integrity consist that the data stored in the database must satisfy. Updating the violate integrity consist or disallowed. Authorization, DCL. The SQL DDL include commands for specific access, write to relational and view. Data definition command in SQL. Define a foreign key for a table, it belongs to a foreign key. Define a draft value of a column, it belongs to a draft. Validate a date in a authority is to click. Permanently delete a table is used to drop table. Permanently delete in an inbox, it used to drop inbox. Permanently delete a view, it's used to drop view. Standard SQL. The standard SQL is standard, but all SQL in a answer or ISO standard that are different variation of the SQL language. However, to compliant with the ANSI standard, they all support at least the major command such as select, update, delete, insert, wherever in a similar manner. RDBMS. RDBMS stands from Relational Database Management System. The Relational Database Management System is the popular database system among organizations across the world. They provide a dependent method of storing and retrieving large amount of data while offering a combination of system performance and else of implementation. The most basic RDBMS functions are related to create, read, update, and delete operations, collectively known as CRUD. They form the foundation of a well-organization system that promotes a consistent treatment of data. Database is the basic for SQL for all model database systems such as MySQL Server, IBM DB2, Oracle, MySQL, and Microsoft Access. Microsoft SQL Server. Microsoft SQL Server was a relational database management system developed by software has a database server. It is a software product with the primary function of storing and retrieving data has a request for other software applications. which may run either on the same computer on other computer access a network. It is a software development by Microsoft, which is implement from the specification of RDBMS. It is also a ORDBMS. It is platform dependent. It is both GUI and command based software, support SQL language, which is an IBM product, and non-procedural command database and case integrity language. It is used to create a database, maintaining database, analyze the data through SQL Server Analyze Service, general report through SQL Server Reporting Service, and carry out ETL operation through SQL Service Integration. IBM and B2. DB2 is a family of data management product, include database service developed by IBM. They initially support their relational model, but were extended to support other relational features and non-relational structures like JSON and XML. DB2 is a family of data management product, include the DB2 relational database. The product feature ALI and powered capability to help to modelize the management of both structured and unstructured data across on a previous and multiple environment by helping to make your data simple and actualize the DB2 family's position your business to purpose the value of AI. Oracle. It database is also known as a simple Oracle also. It is a multi-modal relational database management system mainly designed from enterprise grind corporations and data webinaries. It is one of the first choice for enterprise for cost effect solution for the application and data management. It support SQL has a query language to insert with the database. It database is also known as a simple Oracle also. It is a multi-modal relational database management system mainly designed from enterprise grind underway. It is also one of the four choice for enterprise the cost solution for their applications and data applications type. Standard edition, enterprise edition, expressive edition, and personal edition. Standard edition, basic functionality without most of the advanced features. Switched from background and web applications. Enterprise edition, full set of the database features for machine enterprise and application app. Express edition, simply application and mobile applications. Personal edition, All futures expert management packs, simple used app and Windows. MySQL. It is developed and described and supported by Oracle corporations. The most common of the MySQL, however, is the purpose of web database. It can be used to store anything from a single record of information to an enterprise of availability product on the online stores. MySQL, the most popular open source SQL database management system developed, distributed, and supported by Oracle Corporation. It is a one source relational database management system that allow managing relational database, help to manage relational database using SQL, updating frequently as it is a software. MySQL database service is a full management database service to develop cloud native applications. Microsoft Access. Microsoft Access is an information management tools or relational database that help you store information for reference, reporting, and analysis. Access can also overcome the limitation found when trying to manage large amount of information in Excel or other the separate sheet applications. Microsoft Access is a database management system For Microsoft, they combine the relational Microsoft Jet database engine and a graphical user interface and software development tools. It is a member of the Microsoft 365 suite of applications. It provides all the data definition, data manipulation, and data control features that you need to manage large value of data. You can use an Access desktop database, either a standard alone or DBMS, on a single workstation on or in a shared mode access of network. A desktop database can also act as the data store of data displacement and web page on our computer internet. When you build an application with an Access desktop base access in RDBMS. The demo of the SQL is thanks for listening to my presentation, and thanks to dear teachers and my HOD sir for giving this pleasant opportunities.
Okay, Shuri, for your clean presentation related to the database, I think this is the first presentation in the part of STEM program that specifically we are talking about the database. So for that, I'm thanks to Logeshwari to take over the initiative related to the database, so that the students further can also do some kind of informations that they can give to the database. So now I welcome Ms. Deepika.
Good afternoon, everybody. I am Ms. Deepika from second year Computer Science Department of Engineering, Aruna Engineering College. On this session, we are going to see about the sign language recognition. Without any further delay, we move on to the table of content. In this session, we are going to see what is sign language, SLR, and its necessary helping process of SLR, working procedure, flowchart, features and limitations. At last, we have going to see the future plan of SLR. Now, what is sign language? A language used by the deaf consisting of a system of signs and gestures. A sign language is a way of communicating with others by using the hands and other parts of the body. It should not be confused with body language. Communicating of thoughts or ideas by means of manual signs and gestures between two people who have no language in common. Sign language are an important way for deaf people to communicate. Deaf people often use them instead of spoken language. This language use hands and or understand with their eyes. Deaf people can use sign language because they can feel easily comparing to the spoken languages. They are somewhere between 138 to 300 different types of sign language used around the global today. Next, we have going to see what is SLR. Sign Language Recognizer, SLR, is a tool for recognizing sign language of deaf and dumb people of the world. We create a sign detector which detects number from 1 to 10 that can very easily be extended to cover a vast multitude of other signs and the hand gestures, including the alphabets. Various techniques have been explored for the purpose of efficient sign language recognition. Over time, some were the most effective. It refers to the conversion of gestures into words or alphabets of existing formally spoken language. SLR can be desirable interpreter which can help both the community general and the deaf. Sign language recognition is not something that is too common to all. Moreover, this can be extended to creating automatic editors where the person can easily write by just their hand gestures. Let's we see the next slide. Why do we need SLR? To break the communication problem between deaf people and common people. SLR can help bridge the gap between people with hearing or speech impairment or who use sign language and the rest of society who haven't learned sign language. This leads to enhanced communication for all. About 2 million people are deaf in our world. Deaf people mostly have very great hearing loss, which implies very little or hearing. They often use sign language recognition. They are deprived from various social activities. Deaf and odd of hearing children need to master at least one language to reach their full potential. Providing access to a natural sign language or beneficially to DHS children. Many researchers and practitioners advise families to focus exclusively on spoken language. Sign language and that listening and spoken language are necessary for optional development of deaf children, while practical challenges remain for providing a sign language rich environment. To be clear, some DHS children are not affected by language deprivation because their exposure and degree of access to a spoken language, a signed language, or both was sufficient enough to support full first language mastery on a developmentally appropriate timetable. Next, we are going to see how SLR helps deaf people. SLR is very useful to build a bridge between common people and deaf people. Through this sign language recognition, there is no hesitation to talk to the deaf peoples. We can try to find result of sign language through the recognition. SLR brings the solution for this problem. Suppose a deaf customer went to a shop. He is trying to express his demands to the shopkeeper using sign language, but the shopkeeper cannot understand his demands. SLR captures the signs which shown by the deaf man and convert the signs to text. The text is shown shopkeeper, then the shopkeeper understands what the deaf man is saying. Finally, shopkeeper knows the deaf man demand. When shopkeeper replied to the deaf customer, SLR converts text to sign. This sign is shown to the deaf customer. Now deaf man can understand the shopkeeper's speeches also. A little effort on our part can make a big difference to someone, and chances are that you will benefit from experiences too. Next, sign to text conversion. Finally, recognized gesture is converted into text. This system provides an opportunity for a deaf, dumb people to communicate with a non-signing people without the need of interpreter. In real-time signal language to textual content and speech translation specifically. The very first step is image processing and sign detection. In this image capture, skin color detection and sign detection all should be recorded. Training the system learning model for image to textual content translation, that is reducing the image size. And then the words was formed and sentence also was formed and the entire content is formed. Obtain text output, at last converting sign language to English text. Then we have moved to text to sign conversion process. The very first step is collecting all the text. First, select the text and choose what we want to convert the text. Then the text from the writing place or collected. Separate each letters from the written place. Each letter are separated and put into an array. For each letter, the sign symbol was shown separately. Then we understood and show the sign to the customer. It is a helpful method to talk to a deaf people, sir. Now we are going to see flowchart. The flowchart explains the steps occurring to accomplish the objectives of this project. These steps have been explained in a greater detail below. Capturing the image. The gesture or captured through the web camera, the OpenCV video stream is used to capture the entire signing duration. The stream are processed as grayscale images. Hand region segmentation under hand detection under tracking the captured image or scanned for hand gestures. This is a part of pre-processing before the image is fed to the model to obtain the prediction. These segments containing gestures are made more pronounced. This increases the changes of prediction by many folds. The pre-processed image are fed to the Keras CNN model. The model that has already been trained generates the predicted label. The label with the highest probability is treated. Computing training error and the error is acceptable, then the recognition of training by BP and without any error, stop the training. At last, we found the recognition of sign. Now we see some of the example. Here are some of the examples of sign language. Through this picture, we can know some of the words in sign language like more, help, make, etc. And we see the features of SLR. In single-handed also, they show some gestures like hand shape, hand motion, and consider as features. Increase the vocabulary of our model. Sign language supports better spelling skills and larger vocabulary. National Institute of Child Health and Human Development revealed that signing 2 years old had 50 more words in the vocabulary than non-signing children of the same age. Incorporate feedback mechanism of to make the model more robust. Implementing sign language gives the children a way to communicate without becoming frustrated. That is, they feel annoyed. Since sign language has proven to be effective in improving language skills, parents and teachers would see a great benefit in incorporating it into their program. There is a many type of sign language like ISL, Indian Sign Language, and ASL, American Sign Language, at last BSL, British Sign Language, and so on. Let's see about the limitations of SLR. The main disadvantage of sign language recognition is they are costly and difficult to be used commercially. Classification methods are also varying from researchers. Researchers usually do to develop their own concept based on known methods to give better result in recognizing the sign language. Due to brightness and contrast, sometimes webcam can hardly detect the expected skin color. At last, we're going to see about the future plans of SLR. In future work, proposed system can be developed and implemented using Raspberry Pi. Image processing part should be improved so that system would be able to communicate in both directions. That is, they have improved their ability to hear a wider variety of words languages. We will try to recognize signs which include motion. Moreover, we will focus on converting the sequence of gestures into text. A long short-term memory neural network is used in the paper. The implementing genetic algorithm for sign recognition. Thank you for giving this opportunity to me. Thank you to all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Deepika, for giving the new topic. And I appreciate Deepika to be a startup from the second year. And one of the initiatives that the second year will get an opportunity to be in the part of this STEM program. I think that Deepika will be one of the initiatives for this and make other students to be the part of the program. So I thank all the three speakers of today combined with the faculty. So I just thank Ms. Aparna and Ms. Lokeshwari and Ms. Deepika to take over the session in the right manner and putting some of the strength and over for this STEM program. And today I get some kind of satisfaction, especially in all the presentations that they've given cleanly idea about. They can understand what actually the STEM program is being focused on, the topic passionless, the topic intention, the limitations, as well as in what way the expectations related to the aspects related to the move that we can go for the program. So I just appreciate all the students starting from the beginning of this particular STEM activity until now. We have been progressively moving, and in fact, all the students as well as the faculty, because this particular program is main objective that we want to focus on how the communication skill as well as the technological aspect skill can be able to develop in both faculty as well as to the students. And future, we also communicate with some industrial experts to be joined in this particular session. So that you can able to have an interaction with that, and you can get an opportunity that you can also be one of the speaker with the industry. So that will be again giving another one add-ons to this STEM program. So in future, we will plan for this, that one industrial person, one faculty and one student, so that we can get more strength on this particular aspect. So you will get some kind of an opportunity and some kind of an pride on connecting with an industry expert, so that we can able to broaden our knowledge actually. So I thank all the students to be present over here to make this program to be a success one. And shortly we will visit, and shortly we will be on the next forthcoming month. We will shortly make it about the STEM 15.0 shortly. Thank you, students, to be the part of the program. Thank you all.